to my new community family.
Amen.
It is good to be in the house tonight.
Yes.
I know that last week, Pastor Ed,
yeah,
blew the top off the place. He had to, because when I
came in the name of Jesus,
this past Sunday was so warm in the place. Ready, set, go. when he was focusing on discouragement, he was focusing and he had a lot of depressions that he was dealing with. Let me get to the end first, so you will know where I'm, so you won't lose me or I won't lose you. His focus was on God. Out of all that Paul was going through, out of every obstacle, out of every situation he encountered, he recognized that he needed God. So, out of his own difficulty and experience, Paul tells us that we can find encouragement in God. And he gives us three simple reminders. That's all I want to deal with tonight. Somebody say shriek.
Shriek.
All I want to deal with. We do three, we're good. Then I can let you go.
Amen.
But I am a Baptist preacher. So it takes me a long time. Let me wind up a little bit, all right? So I need your help. What will help me help you?
Amen.
Because I am.
Amen.
No praise. So the first thing we want to deal with is remember what God is to you. Because Paul began his letter with a doxology. And he didn't actually know how to sing. But he knew how to sing about the one who could handle his circumstances.
Okay.
Paul was dealing with a lot of things, and he recognized, as we have come to recognize, the importance of prayer. Yes. But then Paul came to discover, he says prayer is not the only thing. He says praise is just as important.
And
prayer. He says somebody got to learn to praise God. He says praise God simply because he is God.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
All right. Then he says, you will find this phrase about two times in the New Testament. And it said, blessed be God. Ephesians 1 and 3.
Yeah.
For he has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places.
Yeah.
Now, that was the past. That's how he related to the situation of what Ephesians had to say then. He went to the future, and he says in 1 Peter 1 and 3, for the future, he says that praise God for future blessings in a living hope.
All right.
We as Christians and as believers, we have something to look forward to. God has established us with spiritual blessings in the heavenly places.
Amen.
Already.
Yes, yes.
From the foundation of the earth, he's already. But now, having looked back and then looked forward, here's what Paul comes on to say. He says, we need something right now. We got too much stuff that we're dealing with. I understand, I'm not making light of the fact that we have the blessed hope to look forward to.
Yes.
But what about the problems that we're having every day? What about right now, blessed? Somebody needs to say right now.
Right now.
A right now kind of blessing. I need some help.
Right.
I was telling Pastor in our prayers that I was dealing with this little illness that, and they call it, I believe they call it something like vertigo. Anybody familiar?
Yeah.
And know, and have you walking kind of sideways. You want to go one way. But vertigo says go this way. And it pulls you where you don't want to go. And I had to start to say, God, you've been too good to me. I should be able to call on you in times of need and get some kind of answer. And I ended up going all the way downtown Chicago to where I thought I had an appointment earlier last week. Oh, what's that? Yeah. That's right. Charged me $28 tomorrow.
Teach.
The lady told me, so your appointment is for April the 4th. Use some straightening up about then. I was pretty upset. I was 28 light in my mouth. So we came back home and we started praying. We started calling on the name of Jesus. We started telling God, God, listen, I need some help. Man, I can't do. My wife is about to go away for a little while and I'm going to be here by myself. I need some help. I need some right now kind of help. And when I finished praying and my wife finished laying hands on me, I got up and walked straight. I need some right now kind of help. I don't know what you're going through. But I know that there are some challenges out there in this audience right now that would cause you. I believe Marcus, you and your wife was kind of searching for something. And your son was supposed to have been playing ball. And hopefully the team that he was coming up against was a pretty strong team. And for them to be able to pull off a victory, they needed some right now. I hope they won that game. Message was so intertwined with my message that he preached on Sunday. And one of the things that I looked at, and if you go back and you read Psalms 34, you will see as God had given me this message, and I sat there and listened to this pastor preach on Sunday, and how much the scripture and the Spirit of God will line things up for you in such a way that only God can do that, His Spirit. And I was looking at Psalms 100. I was looking at it because I was thinking about the blessings of God, the right now praises that we need. And it says here, he says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Where? In all ye land, everywhere. Amen. And then he says, serve the Lord. Yes. Serve the Lord with what? With march gladness. Yes. I said, wow, thank God. Come before his presence with singing. Yes. Know ye that he is God. And that he has made us and not we ourselves. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Oh, Lord, that fires me up right there. I'm going to have to shout by myself if I can't get no help. And he says that, praises be and thank him and bless his name. For the Lord is good. Generations. All. even that includes us.
Right.
In the community. You engine all generations. When he says all, that includes you.
Amen.
Now, let me try to go a little bit forward, if I may, so that we won't be here all night. I know we're going to be here for a while, but not all night.
All right, preacher.
All right. Amen. All right. So we want to praise him because he is the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Had it not been for Jesus, had it not been for the Lord, then had he not given his Son to us, we couldn't call him Father. There is no way you can enter and call him Father because he has accepted us in the beloved. We are precious to the Father. So whenever the Father and whatever he does for Jesus, he'll do for us.
Amen.
There's no exception to the rule because he is able to do anything he chooses to do.
Yes.
We are dear to the Father because his Son is dear to him. And we are the citizen of his dear kingdom, his dear sons. We are precious, and we belong to him. Now, we also praise him because he is the Father of mercy. Somebody say mercy.
Mercy.
God in his grace gives us what we don't deserve.
Right.
And he keeps from us what we do deserve.
Amen.
Huh? God is forever looking out for us. We praise God because he's the God of comfort. If you know, remember the Holy Spirit. You do know Holy Spirit, right? He is our comforter. He sent our comforter along beside us to help us, to comfort us. He comes along to be able to help us in dire straits when we are in difficult situations. When we need help, the Holy Spirit is there to help us. God encourages us by his Spirit. He encourages us by the Word of God. And sometimes he sends people along beside us to encourage us. He uses a Wendy to encourage us. I gotta call you Wendy because I remember ever since we've been members of this church, you have not done anything but giving us encouraging words. You've always been an encourager. And I also want to mention, let me give some perks to the ushers at the door.
Yes.
Some of the nicest people you ever want to see.
Yes.
Oh my goodness, I could go out and just keep coming in the door. Oh my goodness. Chaplain, how are you today? Oh, wonderful. This is marvelous. I'm telling you, it's some of the nicest people. Look, new community has a blessing just walking and standing around this place.
Amen.
You need to be in passing, just hug everybody. No exception to the rule. So when you find yourself discouraged, somebody say discouraged, and you find it difficult, and you're in difficult situations and circumstances, it's easy to look inside of yourself. Or to start blaming yourself, feeling bad, and that you have problems all around. The first step you need to do is look up with faith and believe that God will do exactly what he said he will do.
Amen.
Realize is that God is who he said he is.
Amen.
I will lift my eyes to the hills from whence cometh my help. All of my help comes from the Lord.
Yes, it does.
Which made heaven.
Hallelujah.
And earth. And then secondly, remember what God does for you. Remember what God does for you. he permits trial to come. Now, let me work this for a little bit. He permits trials to come.
Amen.
Trouble. Tribulations. Stuff. Unwanted stuff. When this message came to me, I was wondering, God, are you sure you want me? Because I don't like to talk about trouble. But he says that we must never think, as believers, we must never think that trouble is an accident. I'm going to say it again. We must never think that trouble is an accident.
Amen.
As a believer, trouble has a divine appointment. Yeah. There any believers in the house?
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen. Yes. Amen. Yes. It says that trouble has his eyes on you. And just like he did, God has his own way of dealing. God has his own way. I need to get warmed up first. I'll be warmed up in a minute. See, there's only three things that can happen when trouble comes. And it's in your trials, in the trials of life. And when these trials come, it can either be faith that you're dealing with or chance. And if you're dealing with faith and chance, remember that faith is just like something like luck, fortune. And if you have trials that you're trying to handle yourself, you might as well be dealing with faith or luck. The best thing to do is trust God.
Yes. Yes, sure.
I'm back to square one. Remember, yes, we talked about God, trusting God.
Yes.
In trials, you need to know that God is available.
Yes.
You need to know that you can lean on him. God encourages us in all of our tribulation. And he does that by teaching us from the word. That it is he who permits trials and trouble to come. I hate to have to say that, because I used to tell people God allows trouble. I don't know what the difference is between what I'm saying now. But to say the Bible tells us that God permits trouble. He sends trouble. He brings trouble. And he brings it for a purpose. Now, let me say, he's in control of any trials that you might have. Anything that you go through, if you go through for the glory of God, God is in control. Okay. Let me read a scripture for you. And that's why I'm here. Okay. I like that. He says, verse 8, for we would not, brethren, have you ignorant of our troubles, which came to us in Asia, that we were pressured out of measure, above all strength, insomuch that we was despaired even of life, but we had the presence or the sentence of death. So, Paul was dealing with some serious matters here, to the point that he felt that he was spared even of his own life. But then, we don't know exactly what those troubles was that he was dealing with. But he says, We ought to know that God is in control of any trouble that you might have. Any trouble that we might go through.
Yes.
It says that when you have trouble, and God's allowed trouble, remember God will not allow you to go through more than you can bear.
Amen.
Forever God is watching trouble and watching you. He is forever allowing you to be cooked and be baked, but he will not allow you to go beyond the ability that you can bear. He keeps his eyes on the thermostat, and he's watching the thermometer, and he will not allow it to rise beyond your ability to bear.
Yeah.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
God enables us to bear our trials. God tells us that when we are weak, then he's strong. We have to give up on ourselves. We have to allow ourselves to surrender. God wants to do something miraculous in our lives, and many a time he sent trouble to be able to help us to understand. God wants us to trust him. Paul had all kinds of gifts and ability and had been through many trials and tribulations. But God says he don't want us to have self-confidence in ourselves, but he wants us to lean not to our own understanding, but in all of our ways, acknowledge him, lean on him. I was reminded of Abraham and Sarah. Sarah was laughing because God said she was going to get pregnant. And Abraham really probably had the same thing in mind. I'm old. I just don't see this. I don't see this happening. But it was not until Abraham and Sarah gave up themselves and emptied themselves of them trying and gave over to God. And then it was God's resurrection power that came inside of them that caused them to be able to bear a son. We have to die self.
Amen.
We have to die to self. Many a times, things are not working in our lives simply because we still have our hand on the controls. We have not released them and given them back to God. Let me move on. Let me move on. God delivers us from our trials. And probably that's where we need to go. In spite of all that we do, God saw, or rather Paul saw, God's hand in front of him, behind him, and around him. Paul used the word distress. Protect means to protect. God does not always deliver us in the way that he wants or we want to be delivered.
Right, right. Yeah.
He sometimes delivers us in a situation.
Yeah.
And then sometimes he delivers us out of a situation.
Yes.
It was James that was beheaded. It was Peter that was released or out of jail. Now, out of both of those, they were delivered, but in a different way. God has his own way of delivering us and delivering us in our trials. God delivers us through our trials.
Yes.
will of God is bringing glory to God through trials, that if we can hang on and not allow the trials of life to cause us to stop pointing fingers, to question that. I'm looking at a program on television. The young lady said, I'm not a Christian anymore. I don't want to be a Christian. I have challenges, I have problems being believing God. And sometimes we can take such hits in our lives and such hurts, and we can suffer, and God allows us to go through these things so that he can grow us and strengthen us, and we'll give up and quit. So sometimes growing means suffering. And I know that's hard to bear. It was hard for me. That's why it's so quiet in this here church right here, right now. Because Paul was never ashamed to be able to ask Christians to pray for him. God's work, he works out purpose in our lives through trials. There are things that we all have to go through in life. I don't want to have to go through it, but it's a part of life. If you're going to grow, you're going to have some experiences in your life. It's called getting some skin on your flesh to toughen you up and get you ready for the next journey. Let me finish this so that you don't go to sleep on me. Somebody's about to yell. He says, remember what God does through you. In times of suffering, most of us are prone to be like a cistern. Do you know what a cistern is? It could be C-I-S-T-E-R-N. It's like the big water tank that's down there that holds water. Do you know what I'm talking about? Some of us, when we go through life, we're like a cistern. We hold stuff. We hold stuff inside. But that is not where God wants us to be. God wants us to be a channel that we might be able to channel blessing on. That we might be able to comfort somebody that needs comforting. God allows us to go through trial and tribulation so we can comfort somebody else. God is not going to let you go through something that, and it's all for your good. It's about helping somebody else along the way. Somebody else needs some help. In your family, in your church, somebody needs some help. And he wants you to be a comforter for them. Can you speak? Can you be a conduit for somebody else? Can you speak a word of encouragement to somebody that needs some help? We're too selfish. We're too focused on our own problems. We're holding on what we ought to be releasing. We need to be able to walk up to a brother or a sister and to be able to say, now listen, I've been through some things. I might not have been through exactly what you've been through, but I can relate to what you're going through. Amen, somebody. Amen, church. Amen. Paul made it clear that we don't have to exactly experience the same thing. We don't exactly have to go through the very ideal thing that another person is going through. I bet you right now, you know somebody in your life right now that needs a word of encouragement. They need to be able to hear a word from you, a word from the Lord. And you think that what you went through is just for you. No, no, no. It's not just for you. When I go to the juvenile detention center and I'm looking at these children are hurt, these children are broken, these are somebody's babies.
Yes.
There's a thing, you got a 16-year-old who's grown, think they know everything. You can't tell them nothing. You got a 17-year-old smelling himself. You got a 15-year-old that don't want to be told nothing. They wanna fight, gang, guns, and drugs. Those children look just like me and you, and they need some help. And the help starts in your house. The help starts right where you are.
Teach. Amen.
Take me where you want me to go, Lord. Help me with this. I didn't come here for you to just call me chaplain and get excited. I have purpose. And you have purpose.
Yes.
You are not living on this earth to just exist. You have purpose. If God gave you a child, you are responsible for rearing that child. You are now a leader. You must give directions. You must be an example. You have to explain to children things that might not have been explained to you. And everything don't require severe punishment.
Thank you. Thank you.
Sometimes we got to sit down and talk about that. Yes. We might need to discuss it just a little bit more. Because mama and daddy of old didn't quite tell us all that we needed to know. But the generation that you're raising is much wiser and much smarter. And so you become the responsible party. When my sons become drug pushers and become alcoholics and violate women, hurt women, I have to question, what did they see in my life? Did I indicate that at all? So when I talk about trial, let's get down to it. Let's talk about right now what's happening in your home. What's happening in my house? I mean, I know when I understand that there, God has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. I understand that. I got that. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And I also understand that if I keep living right, eventually when I get to heaven, there's a blessed hope in the beloved. I'm going to be part of the Christian, the saints. They go marching in. Deal with right now. How you doing at home? Everything all right? Are you fighting a good fight of faith? Now you want to point the finger. Let's look at you. Let's look at me. God, what can I do to be better? Help my life. Better husband.
Amen.
Wives, help me to be a better wife.
Amen.
need to let yesterday go. I need to paint a better picture for my children, for the neighbors. Somebody needs some help. And you are the conduit. God wants to use you. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Oh, man, I didn't mean to get that personal with you. Don't get so quiet on me. Come on, man. Come on, now. I'm finished. I'm about finished. I'm about finished. I'm about ready to wrap it up. Say amen.
Amen.
Go ahead and finish, preacher. Glory to God. So now he says in verse 3, blessed be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. He's the Father of mercies. God had more mercies than you have problems.
Come on now. Yes. That's good.
God has to do a work in us before he can do a work through us. Everybody want to get up and act like they got something. Wait a minute. Let God use you. Let God work through you. Let him clean you out. Can you stand the test? Are you ready? Let the presence of God come in and shine a light in the dark areas. I know what you showed me, but what's in your other hand? What did you hide?
Amen.
So, let me finish. I'm through. No, I'm just like that old saying that said, the preacher is through. He just didn't sit down. In closing, here's what I want to say. Is there is a championship in suffering. It can draw us closer to Christ and to his people. But if we start to wallow in self-pity, suffering will create isolation. And we will build walls instead of bridges. And so what you want to do is be open enough to trust God with your life. And here, in closing, the important thing is to fix your life on God and not on yourself. Remember what God is to you. He is the Father of the Lord Jesus Christ. He's the Father of mercies. And he's the God of all comfort. Remember what God does for you, because he's able to handle your trials and to make them work out for you and his glory. Amen?
Amen.
Remember what God does through you and let him use you to be an encouragement to others. Let the church say amen.
Amen.